हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माय सेल्फ पुष्पन सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 10th of May 2021 एंड एज यू नो दैट दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेसिकली मेंट फॉर दोज हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन कंडक्टेड बाय द यूपीएससी। ऑलराइट, एंड यू प्रोबेबली नोइंग दैट दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेस्ड ऑन द करंट अफेयर्स। The portion was ready for the purpose of your civil services examination, right? And nowadays the weightage from the current affairs is very high, so you should read the daily national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. Apart from that, you can subscribe our lectures on the YouTube also, right? Where we will be providing you the daily basis, you know, these current affairs lectures. All right, so let's begin with the class. Okay. So first news is about the Assam Chief Minister Himanta Biswa Sarma. The Himanta Biswa Sarma is basically have been chosen as a leader of the party, right? Which is basically having secured the majority or having secured, you know, the higher number of seats in the case of the Assam Legislative Assembly elections. Okay. So recently the Himanta Biswa Sarma, right, which is a basically a BJP leader, have been chosen as a leader of the party for the purpose of the 15th Chief Minister of the Assam, right? So he will be sworn as the 15th Chief Minister of Assam. Okay, now the previous Chief Minister of the Assam was the Sarbananda Sonowal, who was also belongs to the BJP. Fine. Now the BJP has retained the power in the state, right? The BJP in the state, along with some of its allies or some of its alliance partners, like you have the Assam Gana Parishad as well as the UPPL, right? Both are basically the alliance partners of the BJP in the state of Assam. Okay, and you must understand, in the previous government of the Chief Minister Sarbananda Sonowal, right, where the Himanta Biswa Sarma have had various portfolios like health, finance, right, which is a very important portfolios which he held in the previous government, right? And as a finance minister, when he was basically a finance minister in the government of Sarbananda Sonowal, right, he was basically earned the distinction of being the first stage to roll out the GST design, when the central government has enacted the GST basically, right? And the Assam was the first state to roll out the GST design in the state. The Himanta Biswa Sarma was basically a chief minister in that time. Fine. So as I told you that the BJP came into the power in the state of Assam, right, after the state legislative assembly elections, along with the partners called Assam Gana Parishad and UPPL. So let us understand briefly about the Assam Gana Parishad. Assam Gana Parishad is basically a state party, or you can say it's a state political party in the state of Assam, right? And the Assam Gana Parishad basically formed after the historic Assam Accord. This Assam Accord was basically signed in 1985, and the Assam Gana Parishad was basically a simple culmination of that accord, and it is basically launched precisely in 1985. Then the second party is UPPL. What is UPPL? That is the United People's Party Liberal. Okay, it is basically again a political party that is located in the Assam. Okay, and it's this party is basically having its headquarters at Kokranjhar town, right, which is basically a town in the Assam, right? The party is actively participated in basically in the Bodoland territorial council elections, right? And this party was earlier led by the former MP that was known as the Urkhao Garwa Brahma. So the UPPL and Assam Gana Parishad both have partnered with the BJP and came into the power in the state of Assam. And Mr. Himanta Biswa Sarma would be sworn as the 15th Chief Minister of Assam. Okay, so he is basically Mr. Himanta. Fine. Next, the Maharana Pratap. As you know that Maharana Pratap was basically born in 1540 and he died in 1597. Right. So the Maharana Pratap Jayanti or Maharana Pratap birth anniversary was celebrated throughout the country. Prime Minister Narendra Modi have paid the tribute to the Maharana Pratap birth anniversary or the Jayanti. Okay, the Pratap Singh or Maharana Pratap basically both have the similar name or similar personality, right? Who was basically the king of Mebar. The king of Mebar is basically a region which is located in the state of Assam. So Mebar or the Mewar is basically a region in the south central part of Rajasthan. Okay, what is the south central part of Rajasthan? You can say that it includes the district, several districts of the Rajasthan. For example, the Bhilwara district, Chittorgarh district, right? The Pratapgarh district, Rajsamand district, Udaipur district, right? And some portion of Jhalawar districts also, right? So it is basically the south central part of Rajasthan consisting of several districts, right? And he was basically the eldest son of Uday Singh II. He was also the founder of the Udaipur city, right? Which is also known as the city of lakes. Fine. And he fought basically the Battle of Haldighati, right? In the Battle of Haldighati that was fought on the 18th June 1576, right? This Battle of Haldighati that was formed between the Mughal forces, right? So what happens is the Battle of Haldighati where, you know, ultimately the Mughal forces were victorious. So what happens is the Mughals were failed to capture the Pratap, right? And ultimately the Pratap was basically escaped. So when what happens is at the Battle of Haldighati, when the Rana, right, has refused to personally submit to the Akbar. Akbar was basically ruler at that point of the time. So Akbar want everyone to surrender before him. So when the Rana was refusing to surrender before the Akbar, right, obviously the war become inevitable. So what happens is this site, which is known as Haldighati, this site is basically a narrow mountain pass. It is a narrow mountain pass at Haldighati near Gogunda in the Rajasthan, right? And the Maharana Pratap basically had the force of around 3000 cavalry and 400 wheel archers, right? And what happens is this fight took place in 1576 between the Kingdom of Mebar. So you have one side, the Kingdom of Mebar, okay, versus the Mughal army. Okay, now the Mughal army was basically led by the King Man Singh. So the King Man Singh basically led the Mughal army against the Kingdom of Mewar, which was led by the Maharana Pratap, right? And as you know that the Man Singh was basically, you know, the general of basically the Mughal emperor, you know, Akbar, and ultimately the Mughals were basically victorious, but they failed to capture the Maharana Pratap. Now, after some time, what happens is around in 1579, when there was rebellions in the Bengal and the Bihar, right? At that point of the time, the Mughal basically loses its grip on the Mewar. So they loses their grip. So ultimately the Mughal pressure on the Mewar was ultimately relieved. Now what happens is after taking this situation or after taking the advantage of this situation in the rebellions of Bengal and the Bihar, the Maharana Pratap again recovered from the western Mewar, right, including the Kumbhalgarh, Udaipur and Gokunda, right? And what happens is at that period of the time when the Mughal pressure was relieved, right, he also built a new capital that is called Chavand near the modern Dungarpur district of Rajasthan. Okay, and the Chetak, right, it is well known a horse, right, who was basically a very faithful horse belonged to the Maharana Pratap. So you have seen also in your textbooks, right, the Chetak is basically also comes in the traditional literatures, which is basically the horse, right, on which the Maharana Pratap used to ride. In the Battle of Haldighati also, the Chetak was accompanied with the Maharana Pratap, right? And some historians also debate that the Chetak was already bounded, right, because of the saving of the life of Maharana Pratap, and ultimately the horse was died because of the bounds. Okay, and as you know that the story also recounts some of the court poems of the Mewar from the 17th century onward. This is all about the literature what we are talking about. Okay, next you also have the Pratap Gaurav Kendra. This Pratap Gaurav Kendra is basically a tourist spot in the Udaipur city of the Rajasthan. It is located in the Tiger Hill, specifically in the Udaipur city. Like, the main purpose of the Pratap Gaurav Kendra is providing the information about the Maharana Pratap, okay, as well as some of the historic heritage which is belong to, you know, some sort of a, that area belongs to the Mewar. Okay, so here you can see the Chetak, which is the very faithful horse, belong to the Maharana Pratap. All right. Next, the Gopal Krishna Gokhale. As you know, that Gopal Krishna Gokhale or G.K. Gokhale was basically the mentor of Mahatma Gandhi. He was also the freedom fighter, right? So recently, the birth anniversary of the social reformer Gopal Krishna Gokhale was celebrated throughout the country, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi have paid a tribute on the birth anniversary of Gopal Krishna Gokhale, right? So you can understand that the Gopal Krishna Gokhale or G.K. Gokhale was basically a very towering figure. He was the freedom fighter as well as the social reformer. He joined the Indian National Congress in 1889, and he was basically a leader of the modern faction of Congress Party, right? What is the modern faction of the Congress Party? As you know, that the moderates that we are talking, right, they were also called the earlier nationalist. So the earlier nationalist, also known as the moderates, right, they were group of the people belongs to the Congress in between, right, in between 1885 to 1907, until the extremists basically came into the arena. Okay, so here their emergence marks the beginning of organized national movement, right, at the national level. And some of the important personalities at that point of the time was the Feroz Shah Mehta, Dadabhai Naroji, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, etc. Right, there was various demands, or there were many demands from the moderate factions, like the Britishers to reduce the taxes which are levied on the Indians, right, and the conducting of the civil services examinations simultaneously in the England and India, because at that point of the time, the civil services examination was only conducted in the England, right, and also there was demands like appointment of the Indians specifically at the higher level of the government post, because at that point of the time, the higher post was basically reserved for the Britishers or for the English persons only, right? And there were other demands like reduction of the expenditure on the military and etc. There were many such demands they were basically having. And in 1905, basically, he was basically elected president of Indian National Congress, okay? And he was basically a leading figure, or he had a basically very leading role, specifically in the Monte Morlemento reforms. And this has basically started the constitutional reform process in our country. Okay. Then he was also having the membership of British India legislature. For example, in 1899, the Gokhale have become, the member of the Bombay Legislative Council. And in 1901, he was also elected to the Imperial Council of Governor General of India. Right. So here you must understand what is this Imperial Council. So Imperial Council of the Governor General of India is basically a culmination of, you can understand that it is an Imperial Legislative Council. Right. What is Imperial Legislative Council? The Imperial Legislative Council is basically a legislature for the British India. Right. In India. Right. It is succeeded by the Council of Governor General of India. And that was subsequently succeeded by the Constituent Assembly. And that was succeeded by the Parliament of India. So it is a natural culmination. When you have initially the Imperial Legislative Council, right, that is the umbrella term. So first of all, you have the Imperial Legislative Council, then you have the Council of the Governor General of India, then you have the Constituent Assembly, and then ultimately you have the Parliament of India. Okay. Then he was also, instrumental in the formation of the Servants of the India Society, right? So the Servants of the India Society was found by him in 1905 in the Maharashtra, in the Pune, right, for the expansion of the education in India. Okay. And the society basically organized many such works specifically for the purpose of education, like founded the schools, right, night classes, mobile libraries, and etc. Okay, as you know, the Servants of the India Society was founded by the Gopal Krishna Gokhale, right? And the aim was to unite and train Indians of the different ethnicities, of the different religions, specifically in the welfare works, right? It was the first such secular organization in our country to devote itself to the underprivileged, to the rural and the tribal peoples for their social cause. Okay. And then you have the Ranade Institute of Economics. As you know that the Ranade Institute of Economics was basically, the oldest institution in our country in terms of the economics. So he was also instrumental in the foundation of the Ranade Institute of Economics. Okay. And ultimately, as you know that the Mahatma Gandhi also written in his autobiography that, you know, the Gopal Krishna Gokhale was the mentor of Mahatma Gandhi itself. So Gandhi called the Gokhale as its mentor. And in 1912, when the Gandhi was basically struggling, right, in terms of your, you have the apartheid policy, specifically in the South Africa, the Gandhi invited the Gokhale, and Gokhale went to the South Africa at the Gandhi's invitation, right? And the Gandhi basically received the personal guidance because he considered the Gokhale as his mentor, right? So in terms of knowledge, in terms of understanding of India, in terms of the common issue, the Gokhale taught the Gandhi or Gokhale aware the Gandhi about all such issues. And the Gokhale was also instrumental in bringing of the English weekly newspaper that is called Hitavad, right? Which is also known as the People's Paper in 1911, right? All right, so here you can see the poster of Gopal Krishna Gokhale. So it is the views of the Gopal Krishna Gokhale. What he said is that what the country need most at the present moment is the spirit of self-sacrifice on the part of our educated young men. And they take it from me, right, as they cannot spend their life in the better cause, right, that raising the moral and intellectual level of their unhappy low caste and promoting their well-being. So that paragraph shows that he was a great social reformer. He was a great social reformer, right? And in that purpose, he also set up the Servants of the India Society also. Okay. Next, you have the Azad Hind Sarkar, or Azad Hind Sarkar, that is also known as simply the Provisional Government of Free India. The Provisional Government of Free India. Okay. Now, as you know that, the freedom fighter, you know, the Lalti Ram, who was basically at 100 years of the age, have recently been passed out. He was also associated with the Indian National Army. So he was the veteran of Indian National Army. He recently passed out at the age of 100. And in terms of the Mr. Lalti Ram, who has also, you know, presented a cap of the pre-independence, the Indian National Army, to the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right, when the 75th anniversary of the proclamation of the Azad Hind Sarkar or the Provisional Government of Free India was basically, you know, celebrated by our freedom fighter Subhash Chandra Bose. So in that occasion of the 75th anniversary of Azad Hind Sarkar, the Lalti Ram basically presented a cap of pre-independence, the Indian National Army, to the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right? So the Azad Hind Sarkar, which is also known as the Provisional Government of Free India, it is also known as Arzi Hukumate Azad Hind, or simply you can directly say that Azad Hind, right? It was a provisional government that was set up, right, during, you know, in the Second World War, with the help of the Subhash Chandra Bose and with the active support of the Japan in Singapore, right? Fine. So you can understand that it was created in October 1943, right? It was specifically with the support of the Empire of the Japan, right? So here, you know, some of the nationalists who were exiled at that point of the time during Second World War, right? So they basically, you know, united among themselves during that period of the time in the Singapore, right? And with that, definitely with the military and with the monetary and the political support of the Japan, which has ultimately led to the culmination of, you know, this provisional government of Free India or Azad Hind Sarkar. And you must understand the government was basically inspired by the concepts of the Subhash Chandra Bose, and ultimately, right, they recognize the Subhash Chandra Bose as the leader of the government or the head of the state for the purpose of the Provisional Government of Free India. Okay. And the army, as you know, that Indian National Army or Azad Hind Fauj was also, you know, they were also fought, you know, a war against the British India or British Indian Army, right, specifically in the Imphal Kohima sector. So the Azad Hind Fauj or Indian National Army, along with, you know, the Imperial Japanese Army, right, they fought a war against the British Indian Army, and it was the first such engagement, right, in the Battle of the Imphal, right, which was under the direct command of the Japanese 15th Army. And ultimately, you know, they were able to successfully breach into the British territory in the Kohima. And ultimately, they suffered a catastrophic defeat. But you must understand that was the first such culmination of the entry of the Azad Hind Fauj into the Kohima sector of the British territory. Okay, so the death of the Bose, you know, unceremoniously, uncertainly, right? It has basically ultimately led to the end of the Azad Hind movement in our country. Okay, so he was basically the Lalti Ram who was presented, a cap of the pre-independence Indian National Army to the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. All right, so that's all for this news. Next, the Laureus World Sports Awards, right? That is being presented for the 2021 to the various sports athletes. So now let us understand what is this Laureus World Sports Award. See, this Laureus World Sports Awards is a basically an annual award ceremony which basically honor individuals or the teams from the world of the sports around all through the sports, right? Along with some of the sporting achievement throughout the year. So this Laureus World Sports Award was basically established in 1999, right? By the Laureus Sports for the Good Foundation, which is basically a foundation for the non-governmental organization, which is having the founding patrons like you have the Damer and Richmond, right? So this Laureus World Sports Award was founded by the Laureus Sports for the Good Foundation by the persons called the Damer and the Richmond, right? So this year, the Rafael Nadal, right, who was basically the Spain's athlete, have been chosen, right, as 2021 the Laureus Sportsman of the Year, right? As well as the fellow tennis player, right? The Rafael Nadal is also, tennis player. The fellow tennis player, right, Naomi Osaka, who belongs to the Japan, have won the top women's honor, right? So here, the Rafael Nadal this year will be awarded the 2021 the Laureus Sportsman Award, as well as the Naomi Osaka would be awarded the top women's honor, specifically the Laureus World Sports Award. So the Japan's Osaka was basically wins her second US Open title this year, and the Rafael Nadal basically fought with the Roger Federer specifically for the 20 Grand Slam titles by claiming the 13th French Open crown this year. Okay, the Nadal basically picked up the fourth Laureus honor. That means he had already presented the three such the Laureus honors in his career, and this was basically one of the greatest feat that he have achieved this year also, right? The German Sauser champion Mr. Bayern Munich also won the last season's Champion League, and he was also named as the team of the year, right? The team of the year. And the Britain's Formula One, right, which is a racing sport, that is the champion Mr. Lewis Hamilton have been claimed as the Athlete Advocate of the Year award, right, which will be presented to him in the Laureus World Sports Award, right, for his involvement against the fight against the racism specifically in the world. And the tennis legend Mr. Benny Jean King was awarded a Lifetime Achievement Award by the Laureus Academy. So these such athletes were basically chosen for the Laureus Award or Laureus World Sports Award this year for the year of 2021. Okay, so here you have had all the their pictures specifically shown here, and he is basically the Rafael Nadal, okay, who has been the Laureus Award of the Year 2021. All right, fine. CBSE Dost for the life. What is CBSE Dost? CBSE Dost is basically an app. It is a basically app. This app was introduced by the Central Board of Secondary Education or CBSE, right, for the purpose of some counselings that will be provided to the students and the patient and to the parents. So it is a psychosocial wellness counseling that will be provided with the help of this mobile application or with the help of this app to the students and to the parents. Right, all right, fine. Now this app, which is known as the CBSE Dost, right, which is basically have been designed for the students for the class 9th to 12th, right? So those students who are studying in the class 9th to 12th, they can use this mobile application or app for the purpose of their counseling sessions, right, that will be started from the 10th of this month onward, right? So previously the CBSE have had this experience of providing this counseling to the number of students across the country, right? But this is, you know, a departure from the existing practice, as now you have some sort of a convenience or some sort of a utility of the students will be provided to the students and the parents also, right, safely at their home environment, right? So earlier the counseling schedules will be provided, you know, in the physical mode, but now these online schedules or, you know, virtual, you know, the counseling will be provided at their home itself. Okay, so through that app, live counseling sessions will be conducted that will be provided free of cost, right? Specifically on the 3 days of the week, say on Monday, Wednesday and a Friday, by the trained counselors. These trained counselors will be providing the life experience, the counseling sessions to reduce the pressure on the students and to guide the students and the parents specifically for the purpose of psycho-counseling, right? So that will provide the information, right, to the students, right, as well as some of the suggestive course guide that will be also provided after plus two, so that they can ease out some pressure, and specifically they will also tell some tips to ease out the mental health and the well-being, right, specifically in the pandemic time like Corona, when you have a lot of pressures regarding that also. Okay, the next you have, you know, the Long March 5B rocket. As you know, the Long March 5B rocket is basically belongs to the China. As you know that it has falling or it has fallen back to the earth. It was sent by the China, but it was unsuccessfully, you know, the China tried unsuccessfully this rocket to the lower orbit, and it was taking, right, some of the segments of the China's, you know, the International Space Station, which is going to be set up in 2022, right? So China is planning to set up a new space station, which is known as the Tena space station, that will be assembled by 2022, right? And this Long March 5B rocket carrying, you know, some core module to such Tena space station, but ultimately it was a failure. So the scientists specifically from the NASA, they were basically critical of this irresponsible behavior of the NASA. It's irresponsible behavior of the China, because as already you know, the China's items do not have the well maintained, you know, the standards, right? So because of that, they do not last long. So this time also, this rocket, which is you can consider of 10-storied height, okay, 10-storied height, right? This much height is the rocket, right? You can understand if that falls on some of the habitable zone, what will happen? Many people would have been killed. But thanks to the rocket ultimately fell to the best of Maldives, specifically in the Indian Ocean. So this, you know, the debris basically disintegrated over the Indian Ocean, and thanks to that, it did not fall on the habitable zone of the Indian population, right? So here the Chinese rocket basically made an uncontrolled re-entry into the Indian or into the Earth atmosphere, right? So what is about this one, the Long March 5B rocket? I have already given you the Long March 5B rocket is basically also known as the Changzheng 5. It is a Chinese heavy lift launch vehicle, right? Which is basically developed by the Chinese Academy of the Launch Vehicle Technology. And this Long March 5B rocket is designed, right, to use the exclusively non-hyperbolic liquid propellants in order to take the heavy lift, you know, the payload, right? So it was launched into the space on April 29th, and it was supposed to be there, right, in the low Earth orbit with the new Tianan space station, which is going to be set up by 2022. But what happens is this was ultimately a failed, right? So why this Chinese rocket, you know, have caused worry across the world? Because whenever it was launched, right, you know, it basically discarded the booster stages, right? You know, whenever it enters the atmosphere, and soon after it lift off, and harmlessly it falls into the ocean, as the standard practice that is happens. Okay, but what happens is this vehicle or this rocket, which is a 10 floor large vehicle of the rocket, which is weighing around 18 metric tons of the weight, right, that went into the orbit, right, and that basically uncontrolled and ultimately came back to the Earth. Okay, now as you understand that the vehicle which was kept rubbing against the air, specifically at the top of the atmosphere, and which basically resulted into some friction, and that friction ultimately led to some, you know, the imbalances in the functioning of the rocket, and ultimately led to the losing of the altitude specifically with that rocket. And you can understand that this piece, which is, you know, hurled through the low Earth orbit, which was traveling roughly at 25,490 kilometers per hour of speed. Okay, this uncontrolled re-entry, which was become inevitable, but you must understand, it is the irresponsible China, always irresponsible China, which did not admit this fact itself till the Sunday when this debris basically falls down, you know, on the Mediterranean, specifically on the Earth atmosphere over the Mediterranean. And this was ultimately splashed nearby the Maldives in the Indian Ocean. Specifically, if you see the latitude and the longitude at that one, at that point of the time. Okay. And ultimately, it did not harm, you know, the humans specifically because of this burning debris. Had it been fall down on the humans, it would have caused the huge injuries specifically to the humans. So what was this panic and what this caused rocket pieces to enter into the orbit? So you can understand that the rocket generally carries a payload. Payload is something that the rocket will have. The rocket is simply a launch vehicle. So payload is something that we send along with the rocket. Okay. And what happens is, whenever the work complete, right, what happens is this booster stages, that is the higher stages, lies with the rocket. They again, you know, ignite. And after completing the job, they basically drop back to the Earth, right? They do not remain in the orbit. So what happens is, this is a routine affair that usually used to do. But what happens is, the space agencies plan to process to ensure that such rocket parts end up in uninhabited areas in the middle of the ocean. And that was happens, luckily, that no one was hurt. Okay. And the China specifically choose not to do this for this Long March rocket, that after completing the work, it should come back, right? But ultimately, it had and basically crashed, you know, uncontrolled way in the Indian Ocean region. So here, the China has 10 more missions. You can understand that until 2022, this 10 more missions also has led to many more such panics across the world, because it sparks the worry about across, you know, the global community that it can cause just like this type of collisions, right? And it can also injure a lot of the people specifically in the world. Okay. Then you have the social stock exchanges. As you understand that, first of all, let us understand what is social stock exchanges, because you people would have not heard about the social stock exchanges. So let us understand first. See, social stock exchange is basically a novel concept in India, right? And you know, it is meant to serve the private and non-profit sector providers by channeling the greater capital to them. So ultimately, it is a simple platform to serve the private sector or non-profit sector by channelizing the greater capital to them, right? And you know, this social sector or this social stock exchange basically can be housed within, you know, the existing stock exchange, like you have the Bombay Stock Exchange or the National Stock Exchange. Okay. So what is the significance of this social stock exchange? Why we are concerning about this, this private and non-profit sectors by channelizing the greater capital to them? Why we are interested? See, what is the significance with that? See, once we set up the social stock exchange, the social welfare enterprises and the non-profits specifically, they could soon get, right? They could soon raise, right? That is so-called the social capital. That is what we call social stock exchange. So they can raise the social capital on the transparent manner, right? Specifically in the electronic form, right? The ultimate aim is to, from the social capital, to rebuild the livelihoods which are raised because of the coronavirus pandemic, okay? Now, you know, these recommendations, you know, if they are implemented, you can understand that it can basically support an ecosystem that will basically enable the non-profit sector to realize its full potential, specifically for the purpose of the social impact. So for that purpose, the social stock exchange was basically set up. So a technical committee, it was basically, you know, in the budget, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, who was also our finance minister, had presented in budget speech in 2019-20 for the purpose of setting up of these social stock exchanges. and pursuance of this budget, right? The SEBI, which is a basically, you know, a market regulator, or you can understand the Security and Exchange Board of India, which is a regulatory body for the purpose of security and exchange and commodity market, right, has set up a working group. And later the SEBI also set up a technical group under the chairmanship of the Harsh Vanwala, who was also the former chairman of NABARD. This technical group basically have given the recommendations, right? So this technical group, which is headed by the Harsh Vanwala, in the pursuance of this finance minister, Ms. Nirmala Sitaraman's budget speech in 2019-20, for the purpose of the setting of the social stock exchanges, this technical group on the social stock exchanges gave the recommendation that for the purpose of the social stock exchange, or for the purpose of, channelizing this capital specifically to the entities that is private or non-profit sector, certain political and the religious organizations, trade organizations, as well as the corporate foundations, they should not be allowed. That means through the platform called social stock exchanges, the political organizations should not be allowed, religious organizations should not be allowed, trade organizations should not be allowed, corporate foundations also should not be allowed, because there is a susceptibility that these corporate organizations, political organizations, religious organizations, their main aim is to not, you know, provide the supportive ecosystem specifically for those, you know, for the social capital, for the social purpose, right? They will definitely have some, you know, the business angle involved, and that will not be having enough utility for these social stock exchanges. Okay, so as I told you that this technical group report also says that both for-profit enterprises and the non-for-profit organization will be eligible to tap the fund, right? Specifically through this, social stock exchange, if they are able to show that their primary goals are social intent and impact, rather than some sort of a business angle or some political angle it involved, okay? Then this technical group also says that these corporate foundations, political organizations, religious organizations, right, they will have, you know, their own hidden agenda behind their involvement in this social stock exchange, rather than their social intent and impact. So they should not be allowed to have the benefit of this social stock exchanges, right? And the social stock exchanges are engaged in at least one of the 15 broad eligible activities for the purpose of raising the funds. And their main target should be to target unreserves, the underprivileged population segments, right? Specifically, that should have at least 67% of their activities that is qualifying as the eligible activities to the target population, right? The report further says that, right, the list of eligible activities that the social enterprises can engage, right, or you can understand that those organizations, those non-profit organizations should be allowed, right, specifically for the purpose of the eradication poverty, eradication hunger, malnutrition, inequality, training to promote the rural sports, right, promoting the gender equality, right, for the purpose of empowerment of the women, LGBT communities, right, slum area development, affordable housing, right, the forest and the wildlife conservation, promoting livelihood, right, specifically the rural and urban areas, financial inclusion. So you could understand that this social stock exchange is basically a mean to serve this sections of the society which is underprivileged, right, which is vulnerable, by channelizing the capital, you know, by these private and non-profit sector firms, specifically with their main intent is to serving those sections of the population which is basically, you know, having some sort of a, you know, impact on the channelizing of those, you know, those funds specifically for the purpose of, you know, serving those sections of the population which is basically underprivileged in the nature. All right. So here you can understand that this is basically the profit and non-profit organization which is basically having the stake specifically in this, you know, the social stock exchange, and the instrument which will be covered through equity, debt, impact bond, right? That will be basically having the instruments, and that disclosure that will be using among social impact reporting, the social impact reporting and other disclosure requirement that may also be, you know, as a part of regulation by the SEBI. SEBI, as you know, SEBI is basically the Security and Exchange Board of India, which is a regulatory body for the security and commodity market in India. This SEBI is under the jurisdiction of Ministry of Finance, and it was set up in 1988, right? And it was given a statutory power in 1992 under SEBI Act of 1992. Okay. Next, you have basically your the XOCD4. See, you must understand the XOCD4 is basically, you know, a new drug, right? Or you can understand a new substance which was recently been, you know, developed by the Israel or Israel's Tel Aviv, the Ichilov Medical Center, right? So Israel has developed this substance known as XOCD4. This substance have been administered to the COVID patients who were basically the moderate to the severe, right? And these patients have recovered, right? Out of 30 patients, 29% are getting well out of this substance. So it is a huge, you know, the development or specifically, you know, great feat or, you know, great achievement specifically for the medical fraternity that the Israel's Tel Aviv Ichilov Medical Center have developed this substance. So you can understand it is a huge breakthrough that the hospital has said that this XOCD24 substance have cured 29 of 30 patients which are recovering well, right? And this medicine is reported to fight the cytokine storm, right? And this cytokine storm is basically a potentially lethal immune overreaction to the coronavirus infections, right? And which is basically responsible for to the death among the patients. So this scientist basically believe that these cytokines, which are the evidence of this immune response called the cytokine storm, right? Where, you know, the body starts to attack its own cells, you can understand, its own cells and its own tissues, rather than just fighting off the virus, and which is basically responsible for the much of the deaths specifically for this disease. So you can understand that the lung infection is inevitable after such deadly virus disease. Okay, next you have the Raghunath Mohapatra. The Raghunath Mohapatra has recently died because of the COVID-19 complications. He was basically, you know, a sculptor and Rajya Sabha member, and he was also the awardee of Padma Vibhushan, right? So he died recently because of COVID-19 pandemic. He was born in 1943 and he died in 2021. He was architect, sculptor, and he was also nominated to the membership of the Rajya Sabha, right? And he was also nominated by the Ministry of External Affairs as a member of Indian Council of Cultural Relations, Government of India, in 2000. So this Indian Council of Cultural Relations is basically an autonomous organization which belongs to the Government of India. The main purpose or the main objective of the Indian Council of Cultural Relations is basically, you know, the cultural exchange, right, with other countries and the people. So the government basically, you know, have the external cultural linkages, right? So India will have the external cultural linkages, right, through this Indian Council of Cultural Relations, right, with other countries and the people, right? Fine. So regarding his awards, he was awarded the Padma Vibhushan in 2013. He was awarded the Padma Bhushan in 2001. He was awarded the Padma Shri in 1976. And he was also awarded the National Award for the Sculpture in 1964. So he was, you know, Mr. Raghunath Mohapatra, who was the great sculptor and awardee or Padma Vibhushan awardee, and he was also the member of Rajya Sabha who died recently because of COVID-19 complications. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. Please take care of yourself because of COVID-19. Stay safe, stay home. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow. Thank you.